Hello and welcome to my second podcast. Today we are again in another beautiful location. This time we are in Bucharest, Romania, in Suter Palace. It's a wonderful location and I'm very happy to be here. And today I have with me another special guest. I will start by introducing my guest, Mr. Eduard Irimia, president of SuperKombat Promotions. Now SuperFilm and SuperKombat Academy. You've been featured on the first edition in Forbes Romania in 2009, and most people know you. You are basically a household name for on the TV channels for associated with kickboxing and fighting promotions. Welcome. And I'm very, very excited today because today we're going to talk about building an worldwide brand. So you started some time ago, about 15 years ago, in roughly about 2009, 2010, you had your first promotion. So I want to find out from you, who was young Eddie and what was his vision when you started?
Thank you very much, Cezar. First of all, I'm glad to be part of your projects now, and I appreciate people speaking about brands. And actually, as a Romanian entrepreneur, not many people knows how difficult it is to build a brand. And I mean, they know that it's difficult, but I mean, to achieve some level in career is not so easy. But because you asked me now a little bit about my background. Actually, everything started as a child. I mean, everybody, if you think about being around the 70s, I'm born in 74, and around 79, 80, I started to see the first movies in my city, Ploiești, close to Bucharest.
So that inspired you to dream about?
Yeah, I mean, in reality, everybody's inspired somehow from movies, entertainment, and books. Even when I was reading the first books, my grandmother was a teacher, and I got you know, a lot of books with from Jules Verne. Somehow the imagination started around reading books, and cinemas also got a big influence. And if you think about from an ex-communist country with very low access on the global entertainment, that years we got only in the cinemas, like some major movies like Superman, Spider-Man, and all Star Wars at that time, and so a lot of Western movies. And I remember that wherever I've been traveling with my father in a city, I was looking for the latest movie available at that time, even it was like movies after 10 years or some older movies at that time. But anyway, it was like an inspiration in entertainment, and I, like any child would like to have a achieve something in his life. I was following my father, who was a boxing trainer and an ex-boxer. So, if you remember the movie Rocky, you know, like the first part.
Everyone remembers.
I think it's one of the most inspirational movies around the world. And somehow, you know, if I take that point with my actual career now, it's amazing to see after almost 35 years to see this projection that I got a lot of convergent lines in my life, starting from meeting a person in Stallone, the actor from Rocky One.
We're gonna get there.
I was trying only to connect to make a connection between the childhood and the inspiration.
So you dream about.
I was a dreamer. I got a lot of dreams. I got that time. I was following my father. I wanted to become like him, to be in boxing, to be a promoter, to be, I don't know, something around that.
What age were you when you had this vision?
Almost from the first grade. I mean, I was like studying in the school. I was following him in different events, boxing events in Romania. I met through referees, fighters, up to different officials. So I was amazed by this world, about this family somehow in the combat sports. So that is the first moment when I was distracted, let's say, from the school, and I was thinking about another vision. And my father saw me a doctor. So I was studying from early anatomies, and I like to become, when I was already in the first grades, I knew everything about the human body, like a lot of myths and a lot of things around related to the human body. So I was like fascinated about knowing a lot of things about science. Being hyperkinetic a little bit faster than other people, I got all the time a step forward with the imagination, and I like to create through my environment with the different friends and everything to do all the time something special to attract the attention somehow, you know. Right. So like any kid is doing something to attract the attention. So I was dreaming to make like a show. If you remember that time, we didn't have access to travel around the world. And
I'm born in 85, so, I'm like 10 years younger than you.
Yeah, but you got a little bit like 4 years.
I've got the 90s, so the 20s.
My father was traveling because of his career as a boxing trainer, so he had access in some of the European countries. I was dreaming to have that right to travel with him. So after the revolution 89 in Romania, suddenly all the gates were open for Romanian people to travel in different countries. So I was actually, to tell you the truth, the first dream came true in London, actually in the UK.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I was traveling to meet that time John W. Robinson in around the 90s. I was a student already in medicine in Romania.
So did you travel to see?
I met a boxing president organization.
Why did you travel? Did you travel especially to meet him
because my father was a boxing trainer and a promoter for smaller events in Romania. I mean,
he was already a promoter.
After that moment when we got everything democracy and the open gates for commercials events, he started to make some professional boxing shows, quite big in Romania, but very low in comparison with the world scene of boxing.
So I want to ask you now, when you were in the 90s, where the revolution ended, you were about 20?
I was in 94, actually I was
94, 20. So you were about 25 then.
Yeah.
And what was your so what was your vision then? What did you wanted to
I wanted create? to do something special for my father, to impress him with a different show, different quality, different broadcasting level than the local TV station in the city of Romania. So I met this amazing personality from boxing world, John W. Robinson, living in UK. He was already old and connected with the global fighters, promoters and management. And the guy saw in me like experience, the potential promoter, like a mentality. So he said, okay, Eduard, you have very good ideas, you can do a lot of things. So he put that seed in my mind that I can become an international promoter. So from that moment, I came back home. I was like in 96, around that period. I was second year in medical school in Bucharest. So I started to think about that I would like to do something bigger as a production. So somehow I was distracted from the school and I started to travel a few times in UK.
We talk in my podcast a lot about writing down the goals, your goals. Did you ever write down the goals?
No. I discovered everything what the people are discussing now at this time, because it's very important.
Yeah.
I got everything natural. I was like the lucky side, one in a million, to have the vision in my mind and to project myself in myself, a projection in my mind. I never wrote, I never did anything. Actually, after many years, I realized that it's helpful if you want to conclude an idea, to make something from 10, 20 ideas. Because in my career, I got so many ideas. I helped a lot of people with my ideas, and somehow I discovered that if you don't follow the idea, you are losing the interest. So that is true.
Yeah.
So you need to focus on something special. So to tell you the truth, I discovered this saying later that if you are doing something what you like, you're never gonna work.
Never gonna work.
So it was in my case. I was so happy to discover this passion, and from that moment, even I didn't have any specialized school in economics or in branding, and I realized that I believe in my brand, I mean, what I was doing, and everything what I did from that moment, I created around this concept about a fighting organization to become at a global level, like somehow like a leadership. So at that time, nobody believed in that. It was like even local people, even my father was like laughing, like, Edward, finish your school, because it's normal. I mean, everybody's trying to protect his child and to not lose him in different
So what did you just... Ignore everyone saying that you can't be done. And you just follow your own.
It was my vision. To tell you the truth, I got my vision combined with my beliefs. So I got a strong, you know, Christian beliefs in my soul. So I was combining a little bit my structure as a business wise, how to make a brand. But also I got some feelings. I got some ideas. I extract even from dreams, even from different empathies, you know, discussion, everything. What kind of project I will do? So I was thinking about a projection to create something big at the global level as a TV coverage, but at the same time to help other people dreaming. You know, it was like not a selfish idea. It was like somehow to create like an empire in this entertainment sport industry. So I was traveling. I met people. I met from each discussion. I extract something. I presented the next level. So it was like a self development somehow in that stage.
You're learning.
Yeah, I learned a lot. And I, instantly, when I got to my first events, I touched the success locally. Mm-hmm. It was like finding a lot of people amazed by that level of events. So instantly, I became, let's say, the leader in the boxing promotion that time in 97, 98 in Romania. And when I felt that taste, it was like I couldn't stop. So I started to make from a local TV show to a European coverage boxing event. But at that time, I got, unfortunately, I somehow slapped by the local older people from boxing, where they say, you cannot do this, you cannot do that, haters and everything.
This is how it's done here.
Or... Yeah, so I was like, you never did this. You cannot teach me because you didn't achieve that level before in that particular production level. So I was a little bit proud. I said, look, I can show you that I can do whenever I want another format. So this is the first example in my career when I was disappointed somehow about the people around that they don't appreciate what I'm doing. So suddenly I changed the format to K1 at that level. I was one time watching that time Eurosport, and I saw an event from Japan called K1. So I said, okay, this is the entertainment combining fighting. So I said, okay, let's make an experiment. So I started local combat at that time with the local TV station in Romania. So it was a format under local combat brand, making a lot of local heroes, creating completely TV format with that TV station. So it was amazing step creating a new concept somehow in the East European country.
So basically everything started in your mind. You had a thought, you had a vision about this, and then you start pushing action, getting teams together, talking local news. It's actually the national.
Yeah, well, the national TV.
The national TV was at the time.
Yeah.
And then you made this possible through your own actions, which I found extraordinary.
Yeah, to tell the truth, it was also an inspiration because we cannot say that time K1 was already existing, but I said I want to do my own version, the European version, combining from boxing to martial arts. So it was nothing original at that time because it was existing already, but in Romania it was not existing, it was completely from zero, from scratch. So instantly I created like around I don't know, 10, 20 local heroes in the next 2 years. It was so big coverage, so big ratings, and I mean, some other people from other countries, they cannot believe that, but I mean, it was like football. So in Romania, at that stage, local combat, it was like ratings. It was a prime time in the biggest national TV, the same time with the major movies from Hollywood. So I already started to compete with the major productions. Like, I even remember one of the news in the press saying that local combat knockout Godzilla. It was the movie at that time. So it seemed that we got a bigger rating than the Godzilla movie as a premiere. So it was an amazing evolution. Heroes, people, money, sponsors, a local TV production. But at one stage, like any other product, needs more gasoline inside and you need to make it the wings bigger. Mm. I dreamt about to become an European level promotion, not only a local. That stage, the local TV was not happy because they realized that I can move from the brand to move at the next level. So they tried to convince me that it's not okay, that it's not, like all the time, no sales, like you don't do this, it's not okay. you're gonna lose the. So, but at the same time, unfortunately, it was a problem in Romania with the space in the TV. They move us the 2 hours later in the evening because of the they consider the sport like violence, coverage, like fighting and everything. So they move us with the 16 plus parental advisor, like plus 16. So it was a difficult moment. So I decided to make an international coverage, not only a local TV show. It was a risky transition because you are losing somehow from the local audience trying to move to the next one. And I rebranded my promotion under the SuperKombat name because it was a local combat. It was a local brand with co-production with that TV station. So it was okay. How should I do my? Could I do myself my own brand to go to the next level? So I, from that moment, I started my baby SuperKombat. This is the actually the we arrive in the branding where I put everything, like it was my own baby, like a brand. So I invested everything. Some people, they are thinking that I create this only to make money, or they don't understand what I, so now it's important to explain to the people that I got a vision how to make that brand at a global level, and of course, at a certain level, we can monetize, we can make it a global brand. So after years and years and years, it's coming the story with UFC, that from nothing, they sold the brand with 4 billion point four around the world. So at that stage, a lot of investors, a lot of people, they say, what? 4 billion, I mean, it's bigger than, Chelsea, or I don't know, as a football team. So even the Formula One was like 7 billion value. So that effort from the Ferditas brothers from Las Vegas, creating that brand at that level, putting money and investing, I was not able to do the same thing without to have an investor. So I started to create, in the same time, major events on the European TV and Eurosport, with the European coverage, with the European setups and the different locations. I got more than 20 events in different countries, and I become shortly like a European leader in this kind of sport, because K1 got bankrupt in Japan, unfortunately. So it was like a moment that I supposed to keep myself alone this product, with not investors, not financial support. I was supporting by myself from sponsors, TVs, and one by one I made these events. It was an amazing the second stage evolution, and now you can put me the next question, because it's a lot to talk about it.
I know you have an amazing story. This is why I wanted to have you here. Your story is, for me, is extraordinary. I find it. I'm so excited about it. I want to find out, because we say that we know that entrepreneurs work a very lonely road. How hard was to put everything together? Because everything sounds very nice and people just see the result of your work. But how difficult was to put everything together to make it happen?
You know, if you want to combine the spiritual life, I mean, if you want to have a clean and soul peace and everything, is difficult. If you want to be an entrepreneur, you take a lot of risk. It was a combination. One time, I'm a family guy, and I'm trying to protect my family. On the other side, this job destroying a little bit the connectivity with the real values with the family, because you need to travel to be around the world. You see your kids next years, like almost the same height like you. So it was like a moment, to tell you the truth, as an advice. Of course, it's nice to become a big entrepreneur. It's nice to be on the Forbes cover story. It's nice to make global events. But it's important how much you are selling from your soul. Because if I would give an advice now to people watching us, it's very important to keep your feet somehow, not on the ground, but a little bit above, not too high. You need to be to have a combination between financial risks, because I need to tell you some of the stories on the other side, so that people understand not only the success, also the dangerous side. So think about that. I was living in a luxury apartment, in like a penthouse in Bucharest. I had the luxury, let's say, car, like what other people are dreaming to have it. But in the same time, I didn't have, in some days, I didn't have the money to put the gas in the car, or to pay the debts of the building, because it was like the people that saw the image, Irimia, Forbes cover story, everything. But all my money, I give you an example. If I had an event for $100,000 cost, I got an income of, in some events, only 70s. So I need to support that 30 difference all the time. So I paid. And after I got a major event in 2010 with the K1, actually the latest, the last event ever of a major K1 in Europe, and I lost like 300,000 that time. So I invite the press in my house. I said, look, do you see this house? I was very open. I said, look, this house, I will sell it tomorrow because I lost, because I knew already what numbers I got from the...
I'm guessing that some people are asking, why would you still go forward if you keep...
Okay, I will tell you now. So I got maybe 50 this kind of negative events in my life. I never gave up. I never stopped on a project because it was like an investment in my future. So now to tell you through the formula, it was like this. I got the projection at a very high level, and I kept that road until today. So it was, I never gave up. A lot of people I lost on the way. Some people they didn't believe. Some people they, maybe they've been disappointed about my high vision. I didn't see them. I didn't pay them attention because you cannot be all the time to blame other people. No, I was keeping my structure for long term. But now the moment we're speaking now, I achieved that dream. And it's not talking about only the money. It's not talking about like results in the career. It's the vision that you are believing in something and you are keeping that strategy. So that is very important. I got an event in Puerto Rico, to give an example, where I arrived in Puerto Rico. The local promoter was bankrupt, and I got all the superstars coming, flights and hotels, everything. I need to pay by myself with my own money in the last minute. So I could say very easily, the event is canceled, let's go home. And I paid the event, I got the debts to pay when I come back home, but I never give up. So the example in 2010, I risked my own property, my own house, only to make that event happening. And now to tell you what is the negative side of the business. Think about that you have some of the biggest fighters in Europe. You are creating them from zero to the global level. So one difficult moment in the career as a producer, as a promoter, you are not able to pay them the date you are promising them on the 15th of December. And you are paying them on the 1st of January.
This is because?
Because of the financial loss. So think about it. You are expecting, after you creating them in the last 5, 7, 10 years, that they are like your family and they understand you. In reality, they didn't understand. Not even one of them. I cannot blame them, but because everybody's got the families, everybody's got kids. So because of that 2 weeks delay, or 1 month delay, because I never got longer payment delays, but for that specific delay, I got so many complaints behind the scenes, sponsors calling me to say, look, I got this fighter calling me, complaining that you didn't pay him the money, so he needs more money from me as a sponsor. So it was like a mess. I arrived in the middle of the hurricane, in 2015, when all the people I created around me, even my staff, even my it was like we call it in medicine autoimmune reaction. Yeah. I mean, your own body is attacking you. So it was like I was like my right and my left, and all these people that are complaining, like, because everybody, they got their vision, they look this they felt the danger around the situation because we didn't have TV stations paying or sponsors at a big level, and myself, I was still believing in my projection. And I'm telling what is the vision actually. I'm telling what is the vision. The vision was to, I said, okay, if I don't have 100 million euro like Glory, my biggest competitor, or the investment from hedge funds in that project, I said, okay, I was exactly on the edge with them like that time in Eurosport, and I said, what should I do to become at the global level? So I choose the American market. And I said, okay, I want to go from the other side of the other door to the Hollywood door. I said, how can I make my brand to be in movies, to be related to global celebrities, where they will have their own favorites, fighters. So it was a crazy concept where I was combining like a league, like a major fighters from around the world, in a concept that they are fighting for different celebrities somehow.
Did you create this by yourself? Sitting in a room.
Yeah, but all the ideas.
Everything happened in your head.
Everything to my career. It was only my ideas, only somehow developed with my people coming with other ideas to finalize the concept. But I mean, the strategy was my own strategy. So that's the side when I didn't have financial support. Suddenly, it's appearing in the market one investor from Germany coming in Mamaya. I got the 2015 in the summer. It was the most important moment. I said, okay, whatever we are dying with the promotion, where we are going to the next level. So I'm finding an investor for negotiating for 10 million euro. This is a reality. I have the documents to prove it to that because I will tell you what happened after that. So I said, okay, at that stage, we got an estimative brand equity value around 30 million euro. Why? Because we've been on the US board for more than 80 events. We got the global exposure. It was a completely formula to develop the. We are not at glory like 100 million investment, not UFC, but for a European, East European launch project, does an amazing job to make. I mean, nobody believed that we can get a equity value like that stage. So I got this German partner with a major luxury car showroom with a Bugatti for millions of euro. It was an amazing. So I got an idea to say, I said, okay, if you want to be like ATP, like Formula One, you need to bring an amazing prize on the market. Because all the time I was dreaming to bring a bigger prize in the system. And at that stage, I was one of the, actually the biggest European promoter paying that prize for that level. I mean, it was not like in boxing at the global level, not like football, but it was for the fighting in K1. It was a really good process in the European level. So I said, okay, let's make a league where the winner is getting a super sport car. Lamborghini or Ferrari. It was a very sexy idea to have.
You had this idea.
Yeah, it was my idea. So when I got this partner, I was so amazed about the concept. One time he was promoting his showroom with the supercars. He's becoming like a super promoted brand. And second, he was my partner as a shareholder in the company. So we opened a company in Hamburg. We opened in the face of in front of the public notary. I mean, it was everything legally with a lot of structure to follow. We opened the office, so everything was perfect. I called my friends, I called my family. I was happy that I shook the hand. It was like an amazing launching of the new business. At that stage, the next day, I called Remy Bonjasky, one of the K1 champions. I called Andrei Stoica from Romania, Boroshan. I called this local star. I said, look, I will give you for you, each of you, a supercar or an amazing luxury car to sign a contract in the new format. Because I need some ambassadors, for example. Actually, we will pay them with a luxury car to be part of like an ambassador in the brand. Of course, they've been very happy and everything. So I arrived home back in Romania. I got the first advance from the that big contract. I stayed like 2 weeks in the holiday in Romania. I was enjoying with that amazing performance. And then we're supposed to start in September the format with 3 events in Germany and Italy in Rome. So it was like semi-finals and the final in Düsseldorf, you know, like major events. So. When I come back in Germany, I realized that this German guy, he was investing everything on the papers, but in reality, he was not backed up financially, and he didn't have that money. So it was like only an intention to be partner, but because the all the contract points, it was like in the next future. So it was nothing to pay me. Beside the car, he sent a supercar in advance, let's say like $200,000 value before.
Did the deal?
So at that moment I realized that something is wrong. I've been in Germany. I discussed with him. He was very aggressive. He said, okay, let's break the contract and everything. But actually the contract, it was like stipulating that 3 million is an advance. So I could put him in a low and to win $3 million. But I was like, okay, the guy is crazy. He doesn't understand the business. So he's compromising my career. But it came like a tornado at the higher level. Because it was like exactly in the moment when I need help. I was again alone trying to fix the situation. So I put him in low. I won after two 3 years, but all these 2-3 years from 2015 to 2018, it was an amazing storm because I was trying to survive with the brand at the global level, but at the same time, I got this low court situation. So after I won, I proved myself that I was with a good intention, but at the same time, I lost some of the people, but they didn't believe me as an entrepreneur.
That's what I wanted to ask you. During this transition period and this issues that you had with this investor, how did your environment change around you?
The people completely. Even my the most important people next to me, they let me slowly they got another projects because they saw in that even myself I never
you're done.
Yeah, they saw me like I'm dying at that stage. So I'm telling you, is that I'm not only lucky. I knew exactly what I'm doing because it was the format. It was the concept. I said, okay, if I didn't find the right guy this time, I will work more at the next level. So what I did, I was investing in the Hollywood area, in my networking, in the agencies, and all these people I knew in that field. I was hunting for the opportunity to be with SuperKombat in a relation with the big movie. So now I cannot lie to you that somehow it was like an epiphany that I got this got the sign, but suddenly somebody's calling me in 2018 from a big agency from Hollywood saying that they need an actor from SuperKombat to come from SuperKombat for my fighters, like a heavyweight, for the Rocky series for Creed 2 as a leading actor. So they asked me, do you have a guy to be a fighter? And suddenly I got the right idea. I found, I had a guy, Floarian Munteanu, who was traveling one day in Bucharest from Munich. He's a Romanian living in Germany. He was a very good looking guy, speaking very good English and good moving as a fighter. So at that stage when I met him, I said, look, you can be an actor. So I was the guy giving the prayer that he can become one of the next superstar in the action movies series. So I invited him in for the casting live by Skype with Sylvester Stallone himself. Mm-hmm. And I got this chance in the 10-15 minutes to convince Stallone that, so the guy was doing a great job, he was deserving his contract. And somehow, these guys, you know, I don't know, in my life I met so many people, but I didn't appreciate what I did for them. You know, fighters, promoters, I helped a lot of people. This guy, for me, it was like the present from God, and myself, I was his present too. You know, it was like 50-50. He cannot say that he made me, he saved me with Hollywood, and I cannot say that I put him in Hollywood. It was like the right moment for both of us. He was jumping as a leading actor in Hollywood. I was jumping as the collections the next day because of the movie with that level of A-list movie with Creed. So suddenly I became like, I was representing him in front of Hollywood, but at the same time I was doing my own deals with my brand, SuperKombat in Creed. So I made a deal with the producer. I put the logo of SuperKombat in all the ring. I don't know if you saw the movie.
I haven't seen the movie yet.
You need to see
it. I should have seen the movie before.
I got like 50 minutes exposure in the movie. So from that moment, for me, the value of the brand is becoming as the one of the craziest story in the world, because it doesn't matter what's going to happen, but the story is going to be forever. It's like a movie, like if you look at the Rocky IV and Rocky V, these kind of movies, to have your own brand in the, and to have a fighting championship somehow involved at that level. So suddenly I met the agents, producers, stories. Like I told to everybody my vision that I want to create like a format combining this vision with movies and the real fighting. They told me, okay, tell me exactly what you want to do. I said, look, you remember Bruce Lee, it was one of the most martial artist superstar at that level, but he was recognized as well as a real fighter somehow.
He was a real fighter.
Yeah, even he didn't participate at the global, but it was like a natural talent with an amazing capability recognized by all of the martial arts that time, you know. So I said, okay, you had Van Damme with Bela Sport, you got Chuck Norris, you got a different personality from Hollywood, but you never had the reality of celebrity, real martial artist fighting in a real cage or ring.
So this is an actual first in the world of the old movies, in all the time, that you have an actual fighter
To see a superstar from movie fighting for real in a real championship. So I said, okay, and he said, what is your input? What can you do? I said, look, let's make the format, if you remember the movie, The Quest. It was the Golden Dragon with Van Damme, and they're fighting for the Golden Dragon, I don't treasure. It was like an action martial arts movie. After Bloodsport, they followed the idea with Van Damme being as a director. So I said, if you remember that time, some of the best fighters around the world, they were fighting for a treasure. So I said, okay, I want to do a real championship to put like a royal family putting a gold on the table, and to have that like a reality show plus the movie itself after that, with the best fighters to be in the movie. So like this, you can shoot two rabbits. We say that you have some of the fighters becoming as superstars in Hollywood business, like Floarian Munteanu became in Creed, and actually coming back in the real fighting. Well, it doesn't. Nobody did that before. So these producers, they came in Bucharest, they discussed with me. We signed a deal. We created a company for making some of the action movies like this. And at this moment in Bucharest right now, one of my partners is producing a movie with Samuel L. Jackson, Michael Keaton, Maggie Q for the 2 months period. So suddenly all the projects I got as a vision, it became true, like branding in the movie, creating some action movies. Now I'm creating three movies, action movies, where I'm shareholder with SuperKombat. So this is the moment where we're collecting the fruits somehow at the biggest level.
Do you think that God has tested you with that period between 2015 and 2018 to see if you're gonna quit or not?
I think I got the test that I would not wish anybody to
to go through this kind of system, because it was like, you know, what is the biggest punishment you can get? You have a reputation as a rich guy. You are appearing in different TV shows or the magazines, and at the same time, you don't have any sustainable sources of finance to keep going at that level. So you are struggling like a normal person working in I don't know UK, for example, with a high image. Of course, you can say, okay, you are lucky that you get a high image and you can get a lot of free locations, resources, everything. That is true. But at the same time, the people are judging because they see that you cannot move. So it was like, I was very open. I was like accepting that without to be ashamed. I said, look,
I don't have the money. I'm not in bigger debts. But it was like a conflict of not being able to continue at that level I was dreaming. So I frozen SuperKombat in 2018. I said, okay, I will wait 2 years until 2020. I didn't stop doing productions in co-productions.
I was
jumping at the next level without to have money in a franchise model, where I'm supporting actually the other local promoters. And my enemies or the haters, they didn't understand. So how is it possible to make events with no money? I said, look, I invented a system where the other dreamers, they want to come at my level, they need to be part of the system and to arrive in my production. So now we are producing at this stage a reality show called Dreammakers Agency with my partner Nora Serusi, an amazing lady who invested in my ideas with a vision to create the same format I did in SuperKombat for any activities. And think about it, right now I'm producing a global pilot with potential to be in one of the biggest OTT platform. Think about to have a reality show I film in 14 countries, starting from Hollywood in the United States to Dubai, Cannes, London. I've been even to Royal Ascot next to the Queen. Nice. To combine the vision that me as a producer, I can take the people, the dreamers, because it actually is all my life. I'm projecting now this reality show. How I help them, how I teach them to become the best version of themselves and to achieve that result. So I took actors, singers, entrepreneurs with me in this reality show. I pushed them in different formats, and I arrived even at the Her Majesty Royal Ascot event, where I'm filming. I need to send you this clip. Maybe put it at the opening when I say 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and the Queen is coming on the door. You know, it's like magic moment for the people. So I did from supercars race around the world, lifestyle events, different mentions, different people, different parties. Trying to explain that if you don't want to lose 15 years like me through this experience and to try all the doors. I know the right key or the right door to take it to the next level through the networking. I mean, I'm selling actually my experience with my global networking. And for example, if you have a vision,
I have some people around me as experts, they choose the best part of your story, and then we are trying to connect it with the right people in your domain to achieve the next level. So everybody's got a dream, and you need to have a solution for that people. So actually, the concept is named the Dream Makers Agency.
The concept is
so actually we are making the dreams coming true. So besides that, we have these movies with the major A-list actors.
We have these movies,
some of them are happening right here in Bucharest. And if you remember when I told you a few days ago why I invited you here in this amazing palace in Bucharest, actually it's the highest point of Bucharest. You can see the Palace of Parliament. This is a boutique hotel in Bucharest where we will film a reality show, bringing celebrities and people to
reality show. Bringing celebrities.
It's going to be like the Harry Potter mansion somehow.
Yeah.
Like a luxury place where the people are dreaming, they are coming here, they are picking up their ticket to the success now in their future. So we are filming from our home place in Bucharest. We are showing that emotion from Romania that we can do a lot of amazing things, even from the other side of the world. You don't need to be in London or in Los Angeles. And I will bring the people from London coming here to achieve their dreams somehow. So it's a global concept. And SuperKombat, I'm telling you that after the first movie is appearing on the global level, and think about to have, just to give you some names, think about you have the brand in a movie with Jackie Chan, in another movie with Stallone, in different action superstars having the brand around them. The people, they will understand the potential of the brand and they will invest the money, but I never had myself to, and I was struggling to arrive at this point. But I'm very happy that I did that myself alone.
So you basically, you had this vision when you started, and now you basically came to that point where everything is coming together, and now you're gonna build up. On, you already have the base now. You're just building up from here.
Now I help other people.
You tell me about this. You created the SuperKombat gyms. Is that the name?
Yeah, but global. Mm-hmm. We have also an idea, and we started an experiment in Bucharest with SuperKombat Academy, where we have an idea of a license for gyms around the world, where the people in SK gyms, they get the opportunity to have like the same format with Floarian, Munteanu, Stallone, to have like a live entertainment media interface, to have castings live from the gym, to have discovering new people from movies. I mean, it's like a connectivity between Hollywood business with the sports. You know, everybody's going to the gym to show their muscle and they want to be part. So we will give that vision on the table to all the cities around the world through our format SK Gym. It's going to be like a super action format where we are creating like a franchise model that you can be part of this vision, to be part of the... You don't need to be a fighter. You could be like an athletic person dreaming to become... to have a chance. So we have our own format of acting coaches, action guys training these people, and our own production, and being involved in these action movies at a high level. We will try to show that vision. So somehow from SuperKombat, we arrive in the super film area where we are creating these productions. And now I'm glad that as an inspiration for other people, we have that result, because at the end is important the result, what is happening.
So, because at the end, it's important the result, what is happening. Because that is the inspiration for other people. If I would not never succeed to arrive at this point, it was like everybody's going to forget about this. The struggle is giving the more power and credibility. I mean, it's normal. If you look even in Hollywood business, you need to see that struggle. You need to see that drama that you arrive in at that point. I mean, think about it. If Everest is going to be, everybody can go there. It's not going to be interesting.
Stallone, when he's done Rocky, he sold it for $250,000, and he had his dog at some point.
And he bought it back.
So, it's crazy.
So you see that.
But in the same time, as I mentioned before, some people they it's like a statistical selection. So it's not so easy. I mean, I would not sell my dream to everybody. I mean, some people they are okay with these projects as a format to jump at the next level. You can be at the next level in different visions. You can become from a chef to master chef. You can become from a fighter to super fighter. But it's not necessary that all of them they will need to project themselves to become the president of their own countries. I don't know. So somehow I was my vision. I was reading a lot. I would not urge other people to do that, but I mean, you need to find your inner power if you can do that. I mean, myself, I felt it. I was all the time confident that I never. I felt all of the inspiration and motivation and movies. I identify myself in them. I never gave up. It was like I'm not a strong person. I can tell you that I'm not. I'm very weak as a feelings. I'm very I'm easily affected by the other people's judgment. So it was like very difficult because I suffer more because of the other people's opinion than my own beliefs. I mean, I knew that I can do it, but I was disappointed why the other people, they don't accept it. I mean, see, I give you an example. When I made this premiere of Rocky Creed II, it was an amazing result to show the movie in the theaters. I got some of the people close to me, they were somehow from the X format, and I was trying to show them, look, I did it. So I was expecting them to get to be warm, to be say, Edward, congratulations. It was amazing. Unfortunately, it was like more haters, you know. So I lost some friends because of that. You know, and that is happening to everybody. It's not only for me.
Is it because one of the things that I'm talking about now is that we have a natural tendency of wanting other people validation, but that validation, you shouldn't need other people validation. You shouldn't need their approval. You need your own approval. So you're disappointed because they didn't.
Because I was expecting my people, I saw that they are my side somehow. Mm. So that is true that the people are affected by your failure, but actually they could be also affected by your success. You know, so sometimes it's important. It's important to get the validation from the right people. I mean, for example, if I'm trying to go to Netflix, I need the validation from Netflix. I don't need to get a validation from the people what they also they are dreaming to do something similar and they will be haters, you know. So actually I was 100% achieving all my performance in front of the final delivery point. I mean, I choose your sport, I made the best ratings on your sport. I wanted to be in Hollywood, I enter in Hollywood. So as long as the people I am working with them, they are happy about my work, I don't care. Now I arrive at that point that I don't care about the other people. I'm laughing at them. And before I was making a joke that so many people, they were laughing about my dreams that I could become a stand-up comedy with success, you know. So I said, if you are laughing about, then why not sell tickets for my own stand-up comedy, you know? So I was making a joke. Yeah. So actually, the people are laughing because they don't accept it. But in reality, they are suffering after that laugh. I mean, they go home and they don't understand. They have their pain inside because they cannot do it.
They look at their life and they look at you and they.
Yeah. So somehow I learned in the latest years that the hate is not good. It's not good. The revenge is not good to come back to pay any war back to anybody. It's good only to succeed you in your career and to take care of your family. I mean, that is the most important. The rest is they will take their lesson from karma, you know. So
I thought this is your mindset is absolutely is just incredible, the way that you've gone through all this hardship and then you came out on the other side. You don't have any resentment in you. You don't have any hate for anyone. You are happy. You are enjoying your life, your success. But if you could go back, let's say 20 years now, knowing what you know now, what would you do different?
First of all, I made the mistake all my career. I never signed contracts with people close to me. For example, if I had a friend working as, I don't know, I took a guy working, let's say, as a PR, you know, for example. I took him to teach him what I know, to take him next to me as a potential, it was like a young guy. And at the end, when somehow the life are separating us in a difficult moment, what I cannot judge him, think about that all the know-how, all the contracts, all the contacts, all the he is using against my promotion. So for him is normal. I mean, if you are asking him, is a normal way to do that. For me, it was like a mistake because usually all the big companies, they have a structure, they have a contract. You cannot do for the number of years the same activity for another competition. You can go to football, you can go to rugby, but you cannot do the same. So I had a lot of mistakes in terms of strategy, but somehow I was more powerful than them and I never needed their help back or to ask them a favor. So it's only a human relation disappointment level, what I passed it a long time ago. The fighters also are the same. I got so many fighters I created from zero to the next level, the highest point in the global market. So somehow if you are not legally prepared to control your power, everything is going to be against your future projection. So that is the biggest mistake. What if I would go back, I would send everybody with the biggest closest and the They will never do something. What I did wrong, I created, I slowed down myself. I needed to work to lose 2-3 years to save some of the issues because of these mistakes. That is one. The second thing, I was the one like in Bible giving all the time the other cheek, you know, like, so I was excusing all the mistakes of the people around me that maybe this time, maybe next time, maybe it's going to come back.
You should have been
I would be from the first one, I would not to punish them, but to change immediately the workers or the, I mean, I would be more like big corporate, changing the CEO the next 3 years.
You will operate more as an organization than as a one.
Yeah, because I put too much affectivity in my business plan, so it's affecting me a lot. I mean, I was like almost losing everything because of these two mistakes, legally and not changing at the right moment. The people give him another chance, another chance, another chance. So the people I give them the biggest chance in next to me, that people they created the biggest problems in terms of credibility. Because the moment you have a person next to you what is not the one the way you want it, and you don't want to give up on that guy, and you are still keeping him next to you, that guy is going to become like a projection of yourself. Like they see him like the right hand of the next. So the moment that person is leaving to another company, some of the people, they will see like that is the asset, that is the core of the business, but the reality is it was not.
Yeah.
So that is my advice to the people, to be very careful with any business plan, any protection of the brands. I got people trying to steal my brands, people trying to make copying my format. Some of them they stole a little bit from the concept, but at the end, what I'm doing now, they need to have hundreds of millions to copy it back. So guys, find your money now. If you want to do a movie with Samuel L. Jackson or I don't know with Jackie Chan, you need to find the 50 million euros. It's not going to be so easy. So at that stage with the events, everybody can do events now in Romania. A lot of people, they are doing some local events at the, let's say, arguable level. So that they are not at that level where they think. But congratulations to them. I mean, it's good to have people believing and somehow they validate you through the copy you are doing to your format. Even they don't accept it, but somehow they are believing in you doing the events from your past events.
They are basically copying or...
So somehow they are in the same... They are feeling that they are alone, but they are in my garden. They are playing somehow under my territory. I mean, they are still supporting somehow my dream. So thank you guys again.
I love that.
I mean, all these people, they are seeing that they do something this moment, beside the 1FC or UFC, I don't know, or Glory. I speak about the local promotions, the local promoters. Nobody's got this... vision. They don't have the courage to think about the global billions. When I said to some people that SuperKombat is going to be the next $1 billion business, they were laughing for 1 week. And I said, look, I'm not going to do the money from the fighting. The fighting is only a hobby. The money you're doing from movies, you're doing from the entertainment, gaming, merchandising, is a complete industry if you enter in that Hollywood business. They will see. I mean,
because they didn't have your vision.
The fighting is only.
They just see war.
Yeah, the fighting is very limited. I mean, the fighting is like, okay, you have a pool arena, 5,000 people, 10,000 people. That is the amount. You cover the cost. The money is coming from the structure of the branding and the potential brand developing in different formats, like movies, I told you.
Yeah.
So to do that, is you need to lose a lot of years behind that.
Tell me, you are one of the, if not the biggest name in. SuperKombat in kickboxing around the world. Tell me how you see UFC.
You know, I'm not considering myself now the biggest or the big. I was the leader in the European market up to 2017, let's say. But now at this stage, I'm at a different level, trying to jump at the global level, as you mentioned, the UFC. UFC has got the power, it's got the industry, it's got the machine, it's got everything as a entertainment, the media structure to do whatever they want for the next 10 year plus. But it's so easy to come with something new and to over the few months, somebody, I don't know if it's going to be me or 1FC or another promotion, if you come with a format that you attract the attention of the people, it's suddenly changing the market because the people are the same. I mean, the consumers are the same. So you cannot be forever a fan of UFC if you don't have the right heroes. And the problem with UFC now is that even they have the best fighters in MMA right now, they are focusing on only Conor McGregor, who is a superstar. And that guy could be instantly, like because of the money and the movies and what can become attractive for him in the next future, they lose the appetite. So instantly another promotion like 1FC in Asia could jump over that market to come with the same level of action-packed events and the major events. So my formula even is not a secret. Let's say it's not a secret, but it's my formula somehow. I'm trying to invest in a local hero in each country. I mean, I'm trying to create a league where the people are fighting like Formula One, like different structures, or in football, where the people are going from the local level to the global level. So it's like an entertainment projection with the reality shows, local structure of the local heroes, dreaming to go to the reality show to the global level. So this is the format we are selling now on the global market. And that is the only ace in the hand I have now is my own movies in co-production with major producer, because the people signing this format, they will be also signing the movies. So we are offering somehow the dream of any UFC.
The UFC don't have that.
No. Only some specific names like, I don't know, Rampage or, I don't know, McGregor, they got the offer separate to be in the movies. I think WWE has got the only sport property in the world where they have also gaming, movies and the entertainment in the same place. That is the format. But with the real fights, SuperKombat is going to be like when it's going to be. I mean, when the moment I will announce the SuperKombat is back on the market, I think that we can say that all the competitors will get instant Parkinson. Like, you know, like so because I will not come back to bring something what I already had. You know. So I will have something what nobody had before.
You have a joker in your hand somewhere.
Yeah. So I already showed the ace in the hand. I mean, the movies, nobody in the world right now, and I'm telling that to UFC, ONE FC, Glory, they don't have the co-production and the shareholding in major movies around the world, or to have their own brand signed for different movies. That we have in the short time bringing to the table.
Have you ever thought about moving from doing Super Combat for kickboxing to martial arts, MMA?
We have now a movie coming up in June 2020, a movie with MMA in the cage, where SuperKombat as a brand is going to be inside with the major actor from Hollywood, the major... okay, I will tell you a secret.
This is a premiere.
At least to give an example what we are doing here. Okay, tell me what is your one of the top three movies promoting martial arts, and that all the kids, they are starting to think about that movie. Think about a movie where some of the martial arts are fighting, and only one hero in that movie became like a superstar in the action movies.
It's Rocky, I would say.
No, I speak about martial arts.
Martial arts. Maybe a Bruce Lee movie, that's where it comes to my mind.
Do you remember the Bloodsport movie?
The what?
Bloodsport. Bloodsport with Van Damme. You don't remember the Bloodsport movie?
Yeah, I think so.
Bloodsport, it was one of the... first movie to attract all the kids, and it was like Van Damme fighting until the end of the tournament with different martial artists around the world.
Yeah.
And that director of the movie, and actually the writer of the script, is Sheldon Lettick. He's a legend in Hollywood as a martial arts. So we signed Sheldon Lettick for the next cage MMA movie we involved with SuperKombat. And think about that, we took the one of the emotion of bringing one of the legends as Sheldon Lettick, if you check on the IMDb, mm-hmm. and bring him now with an actual superstar, I cannot say the name now, one of the A-list actors, young, so to create the idea is to create a new superstar like Bruce Lee or like Van Damme, or like to create at the global level. So this is the idea, to create a synergy between the Hollywood business and the fighting, and at that stage a lot of companies, sponsors, and the movie world is completely different, it's bigger than any other industry in the world at the exposure level. I mean, everybody, they will see it on, digital platform or DVDs or on cinemas. So that is attracting the name of SuperKombat at a higher level.
Nice.
So that is already in the production, pre-production. We are speaking about in the next 3-4 months. So the people, they will watch that.
And do you have a day for SuperKombat coming back, or are you still?
We are trying in 2020, end of the year, to have the launching event somewhere in a major location. Maybe London could be, because I would choose now European cities because of this stage we are speaking about, this crazy panic with the coronavirus around the world. So you see in China what is happening,
yeah.
In Japan the same, in South Korea, exactly the country where it's supposed to be, like I would go to Macau or Hong Kong to do this kind of event, but unfortunately, is for short term is difficult to think about that, but maybe London or one of the big capital in Europe, I would host an event to combine the launching of the movie combining with the promotion of that event. So it's going to be like a joint production between the movie and the
awesome.
Yeah, so I will invite you with
I love your vision.
Thank you very much. So somehow this year the people, they will touch the reality of my dreams, what they didn't understand it before. Only a few people, they understood it. And now all the others, what they didn't, they will see it as a realistic, they will buy tickets to see that movie for sure.
Kill them with your success.
Yeah. No, but I mean, you know, it's normal. Everybody's got this kind of categories, and it's normal. You cannot grow. I mean, I will tell you something. I will never arrive at this point if I would not had haters before. Because the struggle is, you need power. The power is coming from the wish to show to the other people somehow, in my case. That was the truth. So if I would not have that wish to show that I can do it and I can deliver, I would not, maybe I will be the same vision, but a little bit structured in more years. And now it was faster. It was so fast. Then think about it. From 2018, I met Stallone. I got this co-production deal with the movie coming up in 2020 now. So in 2 years I started from an idea to have my own productions now, movies.
Wow. And you mentioned earlier about Creed, so you are the manager of Floarian.
I'm not the manager. I'm only the person. I'm the person pushing him to that level. He was doing great his job in the movie. We're keeping in touch as a friendship and the connectivity through these projects. But I mean, he's got his own management. I put him in touch with. I gave him actually the management from Hollywood as a Gersh agency. So he's only a product, like one of the fighters. I mean, I will never stop to be a manager for one specific actor.
That's awesome. The light died, but that's fine. Tell me, what advice would you give to a young entrepreneur starting now that has a big vision like you had when you were young?
I would give one of the advices to diversify the projects. I mean, to not take only one project. I mean, like, for example, myself, if you see, I got 1,000 multitask projection around the same idea. I mean, for example, if you are doing fast food, for example, you think about the products used for that specific market, the different products around the same industry. I mean, you need to be flexible so you can go left or right in around the same core. I mean, if you spend the energy in a field, it's very good for that. But I mean, think about all the time to know the industry around, because if something happens, you can control your own products. I mean, like I did myself with SuperKombat. My product could die in 2015, and I save it to the entertainment around SuperKombat with the movies. So it's important to have to feel the flow and to be very flexible and dynamic. And the second one is to, as I told you before, never underestimate the power of the mathematics and the statistics and somehow you can fight for a dream, but you can be one of the 99% losers. You know, so it's very important to realize at the right moment that if you go in one direction, could be the dead end. I mean, that is the feeling I got in my life. All the time I got these feelings. I don't know if it's a natural talent, but I mean, I was exactly in the right moment. I knew how to use the next step or the next barrier to put the feet on that and to jump on the next one. I mean, it's very important to not fall down. So you need to have to not sleep, with the success in your bed. You know, it's like you all the time you need to think about what could happen, what could be. So sometimes the pessimistical strategy is helping the optimistical vision. You know, you need to all the time to think about the plan B and plan C and what could be happen if it's something wrong. Like for example, right now, coronavirus affected the industry in China, mm-hmm. in America the investors. So I'm moving now the productions in Europe. You know, like some of the movies.
So you're moving.
So I'm all the time prepared to. I'm trying to make a business where whatever is happening, I'm moving to the next location and I'm doing the same. I'm clonating, copy paste the same format. So that is my case. I'm giving advice from my own experience.
That's I like that. So most entrepreneurs are reading books and trying to self-improve. One of the books that really influenced me is The Art of the Deal by Trump. And Trump talks about this in his book. He says he believes that all successful entrepreneurs have this instinct that you are talking about. Do you believe that to be true?
Yeah, I believe. But now that you gave the example with Mr. Trump, exactly what I said before. For example, I would not choose to be Trump. I would not choose to be. I mean, it's important what is your vision. I mean, for me, I want to become a leader in my industry where I'm trying to show to bring to the fans an emotion what they didn't see for many years. But I would identify myself more as a Richard Branson or like Elon Musk, trying to do something as a technology helping the people. I mean, not to be only like a powerful machine, you know, because Trump is a powerful machine. It became from a businessman like a leader at the most powerful country in the world. So it's like that instinct, of course, is everywhere, is in all these leaders I mentioned before. But it's important how you use this instinct to help. That is my vision. My vision is to do something great and to help other people to develop their own dreams and to give it like a viral format to other people to understand that this is the way. I mean, if you think about it, you could help another 10 people and the other 10 people they can help. It's becoming like a pyramidal, not scam, but it's becoming like a like a visionary help formula. So I don't like the selfish entrepreneurs. I mean, to become the number one in the world, but at the end to walk on the bodies, you know, like how we say it. In
so you want to together, but you want to help others as well in the same.
Yeah, it's the combination between the spiritual life and the business. I mean, it's very important to choose your path. You know, like for me, it's important to achieve something, but not to do anything is possible. Yeah, I mean to destroy it, because I already did by mistake with my family back in the days when I was traveling a lot and I was sacrificing a lot of time with the family. So it's important to how to use, like for example, I'm doing now. I'm doing a movie in Romania, close to my family. I don't do it in China. I don't do it in Las Vegas. You know, I'm trying to do it more close. I'm trying to use the time because actually the most expensive thing in the life is the time. So actually everybody's. They show their books, they show their success, but at the end they are becoming old in a second, you know. So after that, look at the Steve. I don't know. There are many entrepreneurs at the global level. What they got this moment when before to they died, they said nothing in the world is making you happy than your personal peace, you know. So actually we're trying to combine our results with our common interest with the family or the friends, you know.
So are you a spiritual person? Do you pray? Do you meditate?
Yes. I had in my life so many examples of returning that divine, you know, sign. I mean, even it sounds crazy, but I got so many things in my life where I got the right answer in the right moment, and I felt it like a. Even when I got tested, or when I got the result, but I mean, when I did the right thing, even spiritually, I got a boost. I mean, I can tell you as an advice, it doesn't matter if you are a Buddhist or I don't know Christian, it's important to be clean as energy. I mean, don't do mistakes in front of the people. Don't destroy relations. Don't affect people. Don't hate other people because it's going to affect as a karma. I believe in that.
You believe in that is integrity. That's how I see.
Even if you are if you become like somehow to have envy about other performance or other people. No, you need to be like even if you have a guy who doesn't like you, is to say okay, good luck to him. He's okay. What he you don't need to be affected by the success of the other people on the negative way to suffer from that. You need to take an inspiration from other people to make it a better level. Yeah,
do you have any? I love this because I personally meditate. I not necessarily pray, but I do believe in a divine intelligence, if you want. That's how I call it.
Yeah.
And I know is that, and my previous guest, I talked to him, and the same, you know, a successful entrepreneur. And looking at the successful people, they all somehow believe in this spiritual. They have this spiritual side to them. They have a high level of integrity, as you mentioned, and they try to help other people. So yeah. I think that is important. Do you have any mentors or anyone that you look up to at this moment?
No. I don't have mentors, but I have people that I met during the career, where I was inspired about their energy, finding myself somehow in a position similar with them, or it's like more empathy. Let's call it like I was like when I saw somebody struggling, I said, oh, I'm not alone. It's this guy too. So I was to tell you the truth, I didn't find someone to teach me what I don't know. I got only the people spiritually to teach me somehow as a as a priest or as a person spiritually to tell me where I make a mistake or I didn't understand right the spiritual life. But I mean, as a business wise, I was doing everything like against the odds. I mean, I don't follow any book. I don't follow Robert Kiyosaki or Trump or it's like my own.
You don't read?
I negative side of their advice. I mean, don't do this. And I did that. But doing this with the right direction, I was even faster jumping to the next level. I mean, for example, if you think about that, you have a line like this, okay? Uh-huh. So I was jumping straight through, of course, if you're jumping through the good, bad. So I was like a pine through the different levels, but I arrived at that level. So some people, they can do that. Other people, they cannot survive. So it's difficult. So I think I would give an advice that when I arrive at the right moment, maybe in 10 years, I don't know, 20 years from now, if I have that chance, at one stage I will find the formula to express it to the other people. Now it's only like a sign. I get my information. I'm connected to the informational level with my spiritual, connectivity. But I'm asking myself. I'm praying when I'm going to sleep. I put my ideas when I'm going to bed. It's saying that.
You're writing them down.
No. I'm not writing them down. My I told you before,
yeah,
but I tested a few times on the paper. It's working very well because you are focusing more. That is good. But I mean, all the time when I'm doing something the next day, I'm projecting myself beside the prayer. For a few seconds, what I want to do, what I want to achieve. So, like I say, my brain and my subconscious is preparing for the next day. All the time, I'm doing this. It's like a preparation. Or Sunday, when, for example, I'm going sometime to a local monastery next to Bucharest. I'm not going to during the priest session. I'm going after that. I like to be more relaxed to go there, like to have a few ideas. And all the time, I'm projecting myself. I'm thankful to what happened the last week, and I'm praying for the next one. So it's like my own combination. I'm not following specifically a book from the Christian religion, but I'm trying to find the advices from the different people with this kind of behavior, like to be thankful what is happening until now, and to try to actually, when I'm praying, I'm not praying to become rich. I'm not praying for the material side. I'm praying for the health and the strength to pass all these challenges, because that you need from the spiritual life. Some people, they do a mistake, they go to pray for the next car or next building, So it's important to pray for your inner power, like to feel that you are doing the right thing for yourself, for the people around you.
I love that.
Yeah.
That's great. Tell me, because you grew up in the communist Romania. When I was very young as well, I grew up in the communist Romania for a couple of years. Then the communism went away, and I was talking about this previously. Who in my previous guest were talking about money, and there are lots of self-limiting beliefs that we grew up with. I don't know how it was in your family. If you come from a rich family or not, you're gonna tell me in a minute. And we had this discussion about money. Money don't grow in trees. I don't know if you ever heard this before.
Yeah.
There are not enough money around for people. What is your view on these self-limiting beliefs, and how do you see money at this moment?
Of course, the experience of our ancestors, let's say, like from the family to family to family, there are a lot of examples. And if you look at the Jewish mentality, for example, they have a lot of information, but they keep it through the generations. And somehow, if you look at that samples in business, is helping, because it's like a manual of behaving in business, and even in our Romanian culture. If you look at that some advices are very, very good in terms of protecting yourself from the enemies or people trying to take everything what is good from you, or they don't give you anything back. So actually, it's important to have one foot in the sayings and the local cultures, but also actually you need to bring yourself in the actual self development and personal development, because you see now a lot of structures are coming and are explaining. And I was even invited in some events where I was like very like, what can I learn from here? But when I listened for one day that course, I was like, I was coming only to see like an example. There are many things where your brain recognizes some of the messages, or if you find yourself, it's good to try to combine a little bit the roots from what you have from the family or from what you have as a... But unfortunately, there are some families where they give bad advices.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to point to. Did you have in your family these sayings that the money don't grow in trees, there's not enough...
No. But
how do you see this now, after you've gone through? Did you manage to get rid of them?
No, but I mean, some of them are right. I mean, if you take that the money doesn't grow, it's like a translation is that you're not going to get easy money. You're not going to get...
Exactly.
So, it's important how you use that. Mm. And some of the parents, because, for example, if they see a vision, I want my guy to be, my boy to be a doctor or to be a lawyer. Maybe that guy is not prepared for that, or he doesn't like to do that.
Yeah.
So, you need to be flexible as a parent, or like people advising. But I believe that you need to experience... Like for example, myself, I'm guiding from the science, spiritual side and some advices from all generations, all in one. I mean, it's very important to combine the know-how somehow, you know. So that is got even a rhyme, the know-how somehow.
Yeah.
So in my case, I was listening to through my childhood a lot of advices. Mm-hmm. I didn't care about them, but now I discovered them through the in reality. You know? Mm-hmm. So I didn't pay attention at that time, but now I feel them somehow. That is some of the things are related to the reality. But it's important to develop yourself all the time. I mean, you need to learn. You need to maybe at every 5 years you need to find yourself to give an update to the latest version, because some you think about it, all the time the technology in the phones is improving. You need to be also able to improve yourself in the business. And maybe in the 20 years from now, it's going to be only apps and IT, or it's not going to be
gonna.
So we need to be all the time updated to the science and to read and to study a lot of things. But I mean the natural talent, the natural instinct is the you are blessed if you get that, you know, like to get you don't learn in school. I mean my career is based on the natural instinct. It's not based on what I learned. And I give an example. I was, as a Forbes cover story, the first issue in Romania, without to be the richest guy in Romania, I was as a module in the economical science in Bucharest, presented as a case in front of the students. And I don't have the, the level of science or the economical level like that people studying about my case. But somehow they are studying my case. So you see, the natural instinct presented as Eduard Irimia in that specific academic, the people are learning about that case. So they take that example as from nothing, I created something. You know, so it's like, that is the only thing that is unique in my career, because I didn't have let's say that I built something already existing in Romania. It was like a new format completely.
So with all this information now, did you start reading books? Did you start attending network events, conferences? Did you do any of that?
I was invited as a special guest with some of them, and I was somehow a part of it, watching them, and I was behind in the corner somewhere in the last row. And to tell you the truth, I'm not a big fan of most of them. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of them are for the people, let's say, with personal issues, a lot of, they're helping, maybe they get the right answer for them in that, this kind of things. But in some cases, if I look from exterior, maybe 80%, I'm not interested about that. Because it's they say that they're making you to be open, but somehow they're making you directly to a specific point. The next course and the next meeting with another leader. So somehow it's an industry. It's like the religion somehow. You need to come to the discharge to go to... it's important if you have your self-confidence and you have your power to choose from. That is important, because you can go, you listen, you take some ideas, you are using in the next experience.
So you have to take action. That is the idea. If you go to this event,
you have
to take action on whatever you learn that you think is good for you.
Yeah. So it's good. The experience is making the is changing your environment. I mean, it's exactly like a child. If you take him to different ski resorts or sea resorts, of course he's gonna choose from each one of that something to build. So it's the same. If you go, but you don't go to the same class, try to change different aspects, you know, to see different ideas, and at the end you extract something from that. That is my philosophy regarding the personal development.
Is there anything you want to add for the young entrepreneur, for those that are in business now, from your wisdom now you've been in the battle, you are...
So if I took the extraction from all this experience is first of all to think about that the experience of the previous people is important to extract a drop from that. I mean, don't slap all the ideas from your father or from try to extract something to test. Now you have Google, so you if you listen to an opinion, you check it in the research. It's like I'm doing myself with a doctor. If I have I need a pediatrician for my kid, I will check who is that guy. So all the time you make a research. So whatever you do, you take a decision, you do a business, and make a business plan, make a research on what you're going to do. So after that, you can fully load your batteries for the your venture, but never start something by only like an idea after after a club night, you know. So it's better to study the next day to make a research. So here I'm good all the time, even I'm not putting on the paper visions, but I'm studying. If you see my how many papers and how many things I wrote as to build to something as a structure to test it, to compare it, to make the comparison. I make all the time a research about as a study, but I don't put myself in writing my goals, because it's like the goals is already in my mind, but I'm trying to make a research about what I'm doing. So this is my advice, to use the knowledge from behind in your advantage. That is 100%. Exactly like the DNA is transmitting by generations to the other people, you need to use that knowledge in your advantage and to use the experience in the history. And I have a friend who is one of the, he likes so much history that he knows everything. Mm-hmm. So I discussed with him that everything what is happening now in our times, if you look at back in the history, you're going to find each one of these individual moments somehow repeated by history. So then it's the same in business. You try to use what I said here from my experience, try to use from other experience, so you will be careful and to avoid these mistakes from other people. That is the most.
Trust your instincts.
Yeah, the instincts plus to avoid the mistakes of the other people, because you already know, you're already prepared. It's like you stay with your eyes closed and you know that what is going to be the door. So you know better like this, if you have the information.
For coming on the show, on my podcast, I wish you best of luck in the future. I know we're going to see great things from you. I'm really looking forward to see what else you can achieve, because you've come a long way since you started. So I wish you best of luck. So guys, I hope you enjoyed the show. Every month I'll have another special guest. We're going to talk about business, entrepreneurship, maybe sport. I don't know what's going to be, so stay tuned. Don't forget to like and subscribe the video. Follow myself, Cezar _Ionica, and
Eduard Irimia.
You can find us on Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, and so on. Thank you for watching, and I will see you soon. Cheers, bye.